also blessed to be surfers, to be able to enjoy the ocean, and even more blessed to be philosophers and consider the interesting, meaningful questions in life. So thank you very much to Colin and Patrick for allowing me to attend the event for the first time. It's just been just a wonderful trip so far, so thank you so much. So we hold people morally responsible for doing something wrong only when they freely do it. We exempt people from blame when they're innocent victims of, say, coercion or compulsion. Now, there are two competing models of this freedom required for moral responsibility. The alternative possibilities model analyzes freedom, at least partly in terms of the agent's ability to do otherwise. So this is the garden of forking paths metaphor of freedom. So what makes us free in taking the one path of coming in this room is that we could easily take the other path and walk right out that door if we want to. Now, the other model of freedom is the alternative at the actual sequence model of freedom, which analyzes freedom exclusively in terms of the actual sequence of events that issues in the target behavior. So freedom on this view isn't a matter of being able to do otherwise, it's exclusively a matter of the way the action actually goes down. So what makes us free in coming into this room is that we chose to do so according to our own values and preferences. We've got really great coffee, great conversation, great speakers, right? So we valued it, we chose to do that. And so this model analyzes freedom just exclusively in terms of the actual sequence of events. So suppose that unbeknownst to us, somebody came after fixing the electrical room and locked the doors behind us, right? So even if we couldn't do otherwise, we're still freely choosing to be here. And in that sense, there's kind of an intuitive story for sort of what makes us free on the actual sequence. We can break these models down a little bit more specifically. So the alternative possibilities model endorses the famous principle of alternative possibilities, which presents a necessary condition. I interpret it to mean that a person freely buys. So buys here is just a placeholder for any behavior. It could be an action, decision, omission. So the principle says that a person freely buys is required for moral responsibility only if she could have done otherwise in the right sort of way. So suppose that a surfer just got off work right before sunset, the waves are going off at Cardiff Reef, right? Sees just some A-frame barrels, only has about an hour to surf, and then sees a little child being sucked out in those really strong rip currents at Cardiff Reef, and no one's around. Lifeguards are off duty, no parents are to be seen, right? And so the surfer has a decision to make. Do I go surf the barrels or do I go save the child? And unfortunately the surfer says, forget the child, I'm gonna go surf the barrels. Right? So what makes the surfer kind of free on this model, part of that is that the surfer, instead of choosing the wrong thing, could have done otherwise by choosing the right thing. Now, famously, Frankfurt came and critiqued the principle of alternative possibilities in the now famous Frankfurt cases, right? So these are cases in which, intuitively, the individual is free and blameworthy, even though she could not have done otherwise. So consider our surfer again, right? And now suppose that unbeknownst to the surfer, there was a mad scientist who, the night before came in and planted a brain device in the surfer's brain and really wants this surfer to go wrong at every step just to ruin the surfer's life. And so the brain scientist was hiding behind the palm trees, Trace Palms over there, and was watching the surfer. And if there were any indication that the surfer were going to do the right thing by saving the child, the brain scientist would have pushed a button forcing the surfer to choose the wrong thing and go and surf the A-frame barrels, right? But in this case, the mad scientist didn't have to do anything at all because the surfer made the wrong decision all on her own. So the mad scientist didn't have to coerce the surfer. So it seems like in this case, intuitively, the surfer is still kind of blameworthy, right? And free in making that decision, even though she couldn't have done otherwise. It wasn't as if the mad scientist forced her to do anything. She did it all on her own. So even though she wasn't able to do otherwise, still free in the way required for moral responsibility. And so this really kind of set up these new actual sequence models where they begin to try to analyze freedom, providing some sufficient condition for freedom, saying that a person freely buys is required for moral responsibility if her buying exhibits the right sort of actual sequence. So this would be an actual sequence that's free of coercion, of compulsion, one in which, say, the agent is acting according to her own reasons, desires, values, preferences. And a lot of the work in contemporary free will and moral responsibility theory has been in developing these actual sequence models. I'm over there at the University of Arizona. It's team actual sequence. We've got McKenna, Carolina Sartorio. And so you have different models where they're trying to kind of explain, well, what is the right sort of actual sequence? Now, what I noticed, though, was that these actual sequence models made a fatal mistake. They went on to basically do the same thing that the alternative possibilities model did, and that's assumed that a freedom conferring actual sequence is actually necessary for freedom. So this is what we can call the principle of actual sequences, which is the analog of the principle of alternative possibilities. The principle states that a person freely vies as required for moral responsibility only if her vine exhibits the right sort of actual sequence. But this is a major problem that has really gone unseen in the literature, because Frankfurt cases, which are the main motivation for this actual sequence approach, don't demonstrate that freedom conferring actual sequence is necessary for freedom, but only that it's sufficient, and that the ability to do otherwise is not necessary. So this is really an unmotivated assumption. And so part of my research, what I've been trying to do is come up with the parallel cases of the Frankfurt cases called Pap-style cases. Now, these Pap-style cases motivate a reconceptualization of the principle of alternative possibilities as a sufficiency thesis. So we can call it the principle of alternative possibilities sufficiency style. And what it says is that a person freely vies as required for moral responsibility if she could have done otherwise in the right sort of way. And the cases are cases in which intuitively the person is free and blameworthy because she was able to do otherwise. And some of these cases try to function as even more ambitious cases that function as the analogs of these Frankfurt cases, right? So they want to try to show cases in which the individual is intuitively free and responsible even though she lacks a freedom-conferring actual sequence, thus taking out and falsifying the principle of actual sequences. Because if she's free and she lacks a freedom-conferring actual sequence, well then a freedom-conferring actual sequence must not be necessary for freedom. So really just the analog of Frankfurt cases, right? So whereas Frankfurt cases were showing that the individual is intuitively free and blameworthy even though she lacks the ability to do otherwise, these Pap-style cases, at least the ambitious sort, try to show that a person is intuitively free and blameworthy because she's able to do otherwise, even though she lacks a freedom-conferring actual sequence. And so this motivated what a new model of freedom, which I'm calling the dual model of freedom, which really shows that essentially it's a bifurcation fallacy, a false dilemma that we have to choose between the alternative possibilities and actual sequence model. And so according to the dual model, essentially one is free just in case one enjoys the right alternatives or actual sequence. Now this biconditional is the conjunction of two conditionals. So the first conjunction is a weaker necessity principle. And so this one states that a person freely buys is required for moral responsibility only if she could have been otherwise in the right sort of way, or her fine exhibits the right sort of actual sequence. So less formally, we could say that if one is free, then one enjoys the right alternatives or actual sequence. Whereas the principle of alternative possibilities and the principle of actual sequences are really implausible. They're just beleaguered by Frankfurt cases and by these also the Pap-style cases. You know, there's some controversy there. People try to defend PAP. But at this principle here, I'll call it the Pappist principle, which is the principle of alternative possibilities or actual sequences, is super plausible, right? Presumably, if we're free, what makes us free has to be something either about the way the behavior actually unfolded or the way the behavior could have unfolded, right? More aphoristically, if we're free, well then we're free in virtue of the way things are or in virtue of the way things could have been. Seems like an inscrutable theory there. The other conjunction would be the sufficiency. Essentially, what this says is that a person freely vies is required for moral responsibility if she could have done otherwise and vie in the right sort of way, or if her fine exhibits the right sort of actual sequence. In other words, if one enjoys the right alternatives or actual sequence, then one is free. So the model goes ahead and endorses both of the sufficiency theses, the principle of alternative possibilities here and past, and then also past. So essentially, that's the dual model. It jettisons the implausible necessity theses of the competing models, endorses a more plausible disjunctive necessity theses, and then actually also endorses the sufficiency theses of both alternative possibilities and actual sequences. And so today, what I'm going to do is, since these Frankfurt cases have really received no lack of attention, just they've just been debated ad nauseum, right? It really just reaches stalemate between these two competing models here. I'm not going to support the dual model by kind of running fake Frankfurt cases, trying to convince alternative possibilities people that you know, a freedom to infer a natural sequence suffices in the absence of an ability to do otherwise. So I take all of that for granted. I'm going to go ahead and assume that. What I'm going to rather do here is to run the more novel PAP style cases, which have received no attention in the literature, essentially, in support of both the PAP thesis and trying to run some more of the ambitious cases, which try to take out the principle of actual sequence. So let's start with some less ambitious PAP style cases. And my purpose here isn't going to be to develop any of the cases in any kind of depth, but rather to suggest that this PAP style, this PAP thesis, has the power to explain freedom in a real variety of cases. So when the target is, for instance, a decision, an omission, an action, or outcomes. And so I think PAPS has a great deal of explanatory power. So I'll start with the first case here. But again, these cases are going to be